We've all heard about the school of hard knocks. This describes a form of education earned through real-life experiences, often involving challenges and frequent setbacks. And with this constant pounding of adversity, many escape. They go to a path maybe with short-term gain, looking for validation or purpose or reward, but it often leads to a lifetime of crime or drugs, and one could argue ultimate pain. But there's those that graduate from the school of hard knocks. They emerge stronger, wiser, and more resilient. They possess valuable insights because they've seen and smelt humanity at its best and its worst. They got practical skills. They got a deep understanding of life's complexities. It can never be acquired from a textbook or from a teacher. Sean Carter, you probably know him by the name Jay-Z, the rapper, entrepreneur, philanthropist, and billionaire, dropped out of high school, turned to selling drugs in his youth. He credits what he learned on the street as his superpower.
That's just the way the world was set up. But just like the things that we were able to overcome and where we sit now today.
Eminem, another one that dropped out of high school.
Yeah, I would change schools 2-3 times a year. And that was probably the roughest part.
Numerous challenges, including a troubled family life. And he struggled with substance abuse. And I would argue he's one of the great poets of the last 100 years. Steve Jobs, he could only handle one semester at Reed College. Oprah, another one, child incredibly challenging, 9 years old, her mother sends her to live with her father in Tennessee. Supposed to be a fresh start for Oprah. Quickly becomes a nightmare. Father's strict, resorts to physical punishment. Every night he demands that she reads. Interesting enough, cultivates her love for reading. But age 13, Oprah's sent back to live with her mom. Her mother can't provide a stable home. She begins to struggle in school. She's sexually abused. And all of this are circumstances that I think Oprah's unpacked throughout her life to help others.
I think that success is a process. My first Easter speech in the Kosciuszko Baptist Church at the age of 3.5 was the beginning. And that every other speech, every other book I read, every other time I spoke in public was a building block.
These individuals and many more serve as inspiring examples of resilience, determination, the ability to overcome adversity, achieve success, really the foundations of this show. And despite facing these challenges early in life, they turn their lives around. And I would argue, and I have no empirical evidence, they spend most of their time helping others.
This is Chatter That Matters with Tony Chapman, presented by RBC.
My guest today, he's a survivor of the School of Hard Knocks. He's bruised and battered, I would argue mentally shattered. But he's not only learned how to survive, he's learned how to thrive. His name is Shane Howard, and this is Story. Shane, welcome to Chatter That Matters.
Thanks for having me, Tony. Glad to be here.
When I first met you, man, I just saw you as a sort of swagger, the confidence, that just you had your hand on the rudder and things were happening. And when we started to talk about your childhood, I said, man, there was no rudder in your hand at the time, maybe a rudder that was aimed at your head, but not in your hand. So talk to me first about who is Shane Howard today, and then let's unravel back in time just to give people a sense of your journey.
Today, I'm a dad, I'm a friend, I'm an agent to executive speakers and authors, I'm a connector, a friend to world leaders. I'm certainly not where I started in life, for sure.
You know, Steve Cadogan, who I've had on the show and I've shared the stage with on a couple occasions, and if you haven't followed Steve Cadogan, you should, for his thoughts on the future of work really are what's happening in the future of work. And he credits so much of his success to you. You know, he just said that you two built this chemistry. And yeah, but if I looked at your resume, I would say, why would I choose you as my agent? Tell me how that unfolded. How did one of the top speakers in the world and leading thinkers, and arguably one of the most important subjects in the world, decide that you're going to be the Yoda for him in terms of getting him to where he wants to go?
It's a really ironic story, but also one that is kind of played out throughout my life, and I'm sure we'll hit on in different parts. It really goes back to the pandemic. And during the pandemic, my wife at the time was a teacher. And there was a lot of negative talk about teachers when this whole, you know, isolation happened and teachers just sitting home. At the time, I had a 4-year-old, a 7-year-old, and a 13-year-old at home, and my wife at the time was teaching special education. So all without any training, without any preparation, without any of these things. So I, being the person that I am, kind of one of the ribbons that I guess runs through the cloth of my life, is I tend to provide a voice for those people who don't have a voice. And that goes back to my life in different ways. So I started a podcast to showcase the education world. And somehow or another, Steve and I connected. We ended up having a conversation, recorded a podcast for like 2 hours. Ironically, the episode never came out for whatever reason. We talked for another 2 hours afterwards. We built a friendship from there. And then he had this book that's phenomenal, Workquake, that, I mean, entire companies have changed their talent strategy just based off the book. But he reached out to me and said, look, I don't know a lot about marketing. You do. The company that's publishing the book has sent over some PR stuff. Can you look over it? I gave him some feedback. He said, well, can you help me with this? I said, well, it wasn't really the purpose of our friendship, but sure. And then 90 days later, I woke up to an email and he said, look, I've learned more from you in the last 90 days than anybody else I've ever worked with. How do we solidify this relationship? And will you represent me? And now we're much more than colleagues. We're friends. He's very much like a brother to me. I love him like family. He loves me like family. And there's a lot of trust there. There's a lot of communication there. And when you value your word and you value how you want to do things, it plays itself out in a beautiful way if all parties are on the same page.
So if I was listening to you for the first time, like my listeners, they'd say, well, this is a guy that must have had an Ivy League education and solid foundation. I mean, this guy has his act together. He understands values and how to be valued. But, you know, your LinkedIn profile says it all. You relocated 17 times in your first 18 years, navigating challenges like trauma, homelessness, academic struggle. So just give us that sense of what was going on in your early years, and then we'll try to pull out what are some of the superpowers that came from it.
I grew up in Bowling Green, Kentucky, home of the Corvette, small town, small city on I-65, sometimes referred as Little Chicago for different reasons. My mom had me at a young age, got pregnant at 18, had me at 19. Yeah, we were born into poverty. I moved 17 times the first 18 years of my life. Also, life wasn't great. My parents were young and quite frankly, I don't think they really knew how to be parents, and the environment sucked. And I was, you know, around a lot of things, a lot of verbal, physical, mental abuse, a lot of domestic violence in the household. Got to high school at that point, I had already been diagnosed with ADHD, barely graduated high school, was homeless at 2 points during high school, had to kind of more due to my own doing, not necessarily didn't have a place to stay. Just it wasn't the environment for me to be there. Spent most of the time at friends' houses and sleeping on couches and eventually sleeping in my car some, and barely graduated high school. Graduated 154th out of a class of 187, and don't have a college degree. And life, you know, life at those times, it was rough. You know, it's certainly not as rough as others, and not as dangerous as others, but, you know, I grew up on what we call the other side of the tracks. I had a lot of friends and a lot of people around me doing a lot of things, and I didn't get caught. Like, like a lot of us, we've all done things in our youth that we probably shouldn't have done. Some get caught and some don't get caught. I think that's kind of really where it boils down to. And really, I'll tell you, in my younger years, looking back on it is where I really started to develop this self-awareness, and a lot of it had to do with survival. I played basketball. I'm a big guy. I'm 6'6", come from the home of basketball in the state of Kentucky. And, heard, a lot of things that I'd never be this. I'd never be that. Even heard from my parents, you know, you're never going to be anything more than a drug dealer, a drug addict, or a garbage man. None of those three things any young person strives to achieve. I started playing basketball in seventh grade, and I scored 2 points the entire season. Those were scored in the very last game of the seventh grade season on a really, really good team, played with a really good teammates. We actually went undefeated. My eighth grade year, scored 2 points the very first game of the season and did not get into another game. Halfway through the season, I went to my coach and I said, look, I said, is there a reason why we're winning? We're beating these teams. Is there a reason you're not putting me in? And he looked at me and he knew my dad. My dad was also a teacher and a coach. And he said, can I be honest with you? And I said, sure. And he said, I'm not putting you in because I don't want you to embarrass yourself. So I said, okay. I handed all my stuff in. I quit. I went to the payphone, called my mom. Mom was not happy. I ended up having to walk home that day. Pizza Hut used to have this program called Book It. And Book It, if you read certain books, you would get these certificates and then you could go turn them in for a free pizza. And if you got more, you would get different things. A basketball was one of those things. And it's the last time I can purposely remember actually sitting down to read a book from front to back. Ended up getting a basketball, going to the park every day at that point and learning and growing. And then fast forward about 8 months later, actually started the very first game of varsity as a freshman. And then this is where I started to learn. I had a bit more control of my life and control of really what I've learned is I have an ability to kind of push myself from a work ethic standpoint much further than others. And then fast forward to my senior year, could have been the last game of the season. We were in the regional tournament. I ended up getting put in a tight spot to kind of help, step up. Did great. The next day, the front page of the sports page, a full article on me and all these different things. Well, at that point, the coach that had told me he didn't want me to embarrass myself was now the middle school principal. I was working in the office my senior year. And when the paper came out, we had a game the next day. So when the paper came out, I made 100 copies of it and I signed them all and stuffed them in individual envelopes and sent it via the school district courier over to the principal. I knew he would get them at the end of the day. And here he gets these 100 envelopes, open each one because he doesn't know what's in them. The next day, we're at the game and I'm sitting in the locker room. I'm getting prepared for the game and I feel someone come up behind me and they kind of put their arm around me. I won't use the language that he used on here, but he got really close to me. He said, first, you're an a-hole. And second, I'm really proud of you. And to be fair, it's one of the few times in my life that another grown man had ever told me he was proud of me. And it clicked. And I said, oh, wait a second. I can be myself and I can go about things and I can, like, I've got a pulse on things. I've got a maturity on things that are a little bit beyond where I'm at right now at 17 years old. And I started to really understand those things. And that's really kind of, I guess, where the lore of my hard work and my self-awareness and kind of walking my own path started, I guess.
Do you ever think you had a guardian angel? Because, you know, there have to be 100 forks in the road where you could have gone one way versus the other, including, you know, not bothering and get that basketball, you know. Do you think there's some force that's been guiding you, or is it you just wanted to prove people wrong because you knew deep inside you there was something special?
I tell you, that's a wild question, and it's a question that actually took – I'm a big advocate for therapy and mental health. And finally, about 5 years ago, I sat down and did therapy for the first time. And that's the question I sat down with. Why me? Why do I have friends who've been in and out of prison, been in and out of jail, who are dead, or all these things? Why me? The reality of it is I'll never know that answer, but I do believe a lot of it was rooted in, I have a drive to want to prove other people wrong. And ironically, the greatest Kentuckian ever is a gentleman by the name of Muhammad Ali. And, you know, his famous quote is, I'm going to show you how great I am. And that's, I've got him up here in a Funko Pop up here. And yeah, it's very much how I look at things. I actually thrive hiding in plain sight. There's no expectation of me, so there's no pressure. So the only pressure I created was created for myself. So then it goes through. So I don't think I had a guardian angel. I think it's just, I just have a deep desire to prove people wrong.
So I've been following you on LinkedIn and listening to some of your videos and interviews. And I find there really are statements of inner truth. And I'd love you to read the post that starts with "In Moments of Survival."
In moments of survival, our instincts sharpen. We become hypervigilant as we navigate through uncertainty and threat. This heightened awareness, while crucial in times of danger, often manifests outwardly as controlling behavior. To the outside world, it may seem unnecessary or excessive, but for us, it's a way to predict and manage the outcomes of our environment, a basic human need for safety and predictability.
So, I mean, you've got this 6'6" frame. You've got this intensity and work ethic. When did you learn to balance the two so that it wasn't simply about survival and protecting yourself and others that matter to you, and it became much more about purpose?
I don't remember exactly when I did it, but I started to talk openly about my past. And I started to talk openly about the things that I've been through. And what that created was, at a very young age, I was working in the automotive business at a Cadillac dealership. And I was very successful, very young at 20 years old, and got into a position of training others and overseeing others at a young age. And what that did, it saw me sharing things about my life, and it saw men who I looked up to who were older than me. I was in my 20s and they're in their mid-30s, mid-40s, mid-50s, and seeing them inspired by the things that I'm saying and pull me aside and say, hey, you know, I heard you talk about this thing about your childhood. I'd never dealt with my stuff, and I started therapy here and, you know, these things. So I started to see this power in sharing, and the purpose that it gave me. It says, wait a second. Because I always asked as a young kid, like, why am I going through this? Why do I have to deal with this? You know, I remember waking up one night, and my parents fought all the time. And I remember waking up one night and going down the hallway and kind of looking in and seeing my mom have a shotgun to my dad's head. And it's like, why do I have to see these things? And I would ask kids, have you ever seen this? Your parents ever done this? Like, nah, man, like, that's crazy. Like, no, that's not normal. Yes, I have a big frame. I'm 6'6". I'm a big guy. I've got big shoulders. I've got a big voice, a big story. And I believe it's because I can show that the lessons that I've learned, and I can be an advocate for these things. And when I talk about mental health, and I talk about openness about men crying or sharing your trauma, it kind of takes the weight off of a lot of men's shoulders when they hear and see a guy like myself be vulnerable. And vulnerability is ultimately the superpower that I think I've gained through all of these things, throughout my life, even still today that I go through.
So Shane, it's interesting. The first irony is that, you know, someone that was homeless and extreme poverty is doing well selling Cadillacs. How did you come to, or did you ever get to the point where you could like these customers because they could come in and they had money and they had, it's just curious about the customers and what, how did that impact you at that young age?
Yeah, no, the irony of it is I've never changed oil in a car. My family owned 3 or 4 cars my entire life. Never changed tires on a car. Got the job because they needed some car salespeople back in those days were a dime a dozen. And they were like, you know, run them in and out of a dealership here in the States. So I'll tell you why I never looked at it that way. The gentleman that I worked for, was a gentleman by the name of Cornelius Martin. He has since passed away. But he was one of 17, grew up in Kentucky, started working, changing oil in a dealership, and went all the way through and worked his way up in sales and was the number 2 Buick salesman in North America, and then ended up becoming an owner and was one of the top minority owners in the United States, minority auto dealers in the United States, owned the fueling rights to the local airport, had a Learjet, 2 private jets. And he kind of took me under his wing, and we had a lot of private conversations. I would have a lot of conversations outside of work and lunch and these different things. And yeah, I think I just always developed and had an appreciation and saw people for people. And that's something that I do strive. I see all people for who they are. I'm probably someone that you would consider an anti-racist and these different things, just because I just see people for who they are. If you're a jerk, it doesn't matter the color of your skin, your race, your religion, you're a jerk. That's what it is. So
my guest today is Shane Howard. I opened the show saying he's graduated from the School of Hard Knocks, where he's got a new diploma. He's one of the most influential people in Portugal. Think of him as a monk. Stick around to find out why.
Hi, it's Tony Chapman, host of Chatter That Matters, presented by RBC. I'd like to give a big shout out to RBC's Future Launch, a $500 million decade-long commitment to help prepare 3 million youth for the future of work. And how? Providing young people access to meaningful employment through work experience, skills development opportunities, networking solutions, and mental well-being support and services. Powering today's youth for the jobs of tomorrow, that matters to RBC.
Really good people out there don't want to fit in this linear path of I graduate, I go in, I sit down, and you tell me what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. It's the novelty of being able to say, oh, I just want something new. The workforce has changed. You can label it millennials, Gen Z, whatever you want to. I know 45-year-old men and women who are like, hey, I want to try something different.
You're listening to Chatter That Matters with Tony Chapman, presented by RBC.
My guest today is Shane Howard. He's a true graduate of the School of Hard Knocks. And now he teaches those important lessons to those who need them most, not just in Portugal, but around the world. Shane, talk to me about the music industry. Obviously, selling cars is commission. You start to get a taste of risk and reward. But how does that factor into the music business? What's that all about?
So had a friend. I went to college, didn't go to class, met a guy. He was from Miami, and he was wanting to get into the music business. I have ADHD, and I'm able to go down these rabbit holes and know how to connect the dots, and ended up connecting a bunch of different dots and made a lot of really good friends and worked with a lot of really big, some of the biggest. Actually, I helped one of the biggest. I won't say his name for different reasons, but I helped one of the biggest artists ever out of Canada get his first record deal. But ultimately, was young and foolish and didn't have a lot of paperwork in place and learned a lot of lessons. But ultimately, I'm very grateful for those lessons that I've learned, because what it allowed me to do is, again, allow me to go into a different realm of something that I knew nothing about and thrive and become very, very successful. And that's a pattern that's kind of played out in my life, even into what I did next. And starting my first real business is what I call it.
I'll get into that first business in a second, but I'm curious. You talked about how your parents got married too young and had kids too young.
Yeah.
But in your early 20s, you followed the same playbook, get married and have your own kids. Why did you think it might work for you?
So I wish I had the foresight to believe that that playbook would work for me, but I didn't. And got married at a young age, young love, got married, had kids is what you do. You know, I had two kids by the time I was 23, and then my next son came along at 26. You're right. Most people, everything I tried to do to take me away from where I grew up. When I built my first house in the county that we lived in, I literally built my house almost in another county. It was as far in that county as you possibly could go. And I've always tried to not outrun my past, but build myself up in a way that no one from my life and no one from my past can ever see me, and they learn about what I'm doing. And even what I'm doing, they say, no, there's no way. That's not Shane. I do not believe it. And that happens. That happens on a very regular basis. But my kids, ironically, my younger two kids, they actually saved my life in a lot of ways. Because it made me realize and say, okay, like, something shifts. We all have heard the stories about people when they have kids and they say, oh, what, like, it changes you. I don't know the biology or psychology of what that is, but I had those moments like, okay, like, I'm not going to spank my kids. I'm not going to, you know, abuse my kids. I'm not going to abuse their mother. I'm not going to, you know, these different things. And you just have these shift of like, I'm never going to be that person or those people, you know, that raised me and the environment that I grew up in.
You know, one of the key words that emerged when I'm talking to you is pivot. The music business doesn't come along. You find yourself going through a divorce, three kids, $1,500 in your pocket, a lot of cement to be standing in. But not only do you chisel your way out, but you build yourself one incredible business. Tell us that story.
Yeah. So to add an even extra layer of cement to trudge through, it was in 2008, 2009, in great economic times, as we know, in the world. And yeah, I went through a divorce at $1,500 to my name. My girlfriend at the time, who ended up becoming my wife, I was sitting around. I'd gotten out of the car business. Car business was not an environment you wanted to be in those economic times. Started, ironically, said, well, look, I'm going to coach high school basketball. And one of my best friends at the time had gotten a head coaching job. I took that job as an assistant and worked in a special education room that I believe it was at what is classified as an MSD room. So multiple severe disabilities. So supporting middle school kids with bathroom issues, with feeding issues, with behavioral issues, and very humbling coming out of making really good money in the car business to do that. But I wanted to learn something different. Quickly learned that I had a knack to kind of connect people. One of the local universities approached me after the season and said, look, we've watched you coach all year. I'd love for you to be my assistant. You have a sales background and I think you can help me recruit. And I said, look, I don't know anything about college recruiting. And it was spring break time. We were going to Florida, where my ex-wife is from. And I said, look, if I can get 5 kids to show up for a workout, when I get back, I'll make some phone calls. When I get back, I'll take the job. If I can't, I'm not going to take the job, because if I can't get kids to show up, I'm not going to be able to help you. I get back, we had 22 kids show up, and I said, okay, something's here. Okay. Made a few other connections. Fast forward through that situation was not what it had perceived to be. That coach was not who he had portrayed himself. A lot of things that didn't really line up, but I had this feeling that I could help more kids in the process and the world of sports recruiting for what I call a majority of kids. I'm not talking about your high profile Division I athletes. That's only 20% of all the college athletes in the world. There's 80% of them are at schools you've never heard of and doing other things. So I said, those are the kids, again, looking back on how I grew up in life, those are the kids, those are the families that need help. And had an idea and called a friend of mine who had a financial investment firm and legally helped me flip in penny stocks, helped me flip $1,500 into about $4,500 so I could buy a computer and incorporate a business and all of those different things. And I ended up starting a business known as Custom College Recruiting. It was a sports recruiting platform that helped high school age athletes access opportunities into U.S. universities. Grew into something I never could have foreseen, into us servicing folks in 53 different countries around the world, partnering with the entire country of Australia, New Zealand, the Minister of Education in Shanghai, China, and so on.
Shane, one of the ways I wanted to play out this story was to bring in some of the lessons that you share in social media.
Yeah.
Maybe you could read another one for us.
Imagine what could happen if we allowed ourselves to look beyond our past struggles. What if we could recognize and embrace the beauty and opportunities that lie right before us? By doing so, we open ourselves to experiences we've always dreamed of, meaningful relationships, personal growth, and moments of pure joy.
Shane, with age and experience, we often find ourselves becoming the mentor. In your case, you're sitting down with someone, you're having an honest conversation. What do you hope they walk away with?
Yeah, ultimately, how I approach those things is with raw, radical transparency about my life and my mistakes and my failures. And most of the time, it's mentoring young men or older men. I say older. I'm 40. I'll be 44 this year, but men my age. And it's communication and sharing, because there's this weight that we all carry. And oftentimes it's associated with imposter syndrome and these different things that happen. But when we look beyond our past, when we say our past, so I'm in the process of writing a book, called Your Trauma is Your Superpower. And ultimately, when we look beyond our past, when we look beyond and actually find the lessons within the things that we've went through, and why did I go through this? What is my role in this? And it takes a lot of, I mean, this is not easy stuff to do, but when you do that, you start to see the opportunities that exist. Once you get out of your own way, and once you allow your past to get out of, you know, to get out of your way, you start to see these things as, wait a second, because I'm so focused and so afraid to hold on to these things from my past. You know, the world tells me I can't talk about my life. I can't talk about my trauma. I can't talk about my failed relationships. I can't talk about when I screwed up as a parent. I can't talk about the time I got fired at my job. I can't talk about these things. And the reality of it is that's actually where all the good stuff is. That's actually where the things that we really learn who we are and define us and build character in these things. And when we look past those things, we see, wait a second. Oh, okay. Now I know here's that misstep. Let me shift just to the right, just a little bit as I'm moving forward. And it's going to clear that path a little bit more.
You know, I really celebrate what you're saying. I relate to it. This is what this show is all about. Positivity and possibility to counter negativity and a growing sense of impossibility. When I talk to young people, though, there's a lot that feel defeated. The planet's going to burn up. AI is going to take away my job. I'll never be able to buy a house. A lot of it's grounded in reality. What's your advice to them so they can see opportunity instead of saying, why bother? Life's a lost cause.
I mentor and talk to a lot of young folks myself as well. And my message is really raw and uncut. What's the alternative? So I grew up the same thing. I don't have a college degree. I had teachers telling me I'd never be anything. All these things I can remember. I remember, certainly don't want to get into politics, but I remember when Trump was running. Not a Trump fan. I was around people. They're complaining. He got elected. He got this. I said, I don't like him. But the reality of it is whoever the president is, they could go and they could put something in place that now taxes small business owners 78%. I still have bills to pay. I still got payroll to meet. I still have all these things. I have to figure it out. I don't have a choice. And the reality of it is we can gripe and complain. And you can do that. I gripe and complain. We're all human. There's things I complain about. But we still have to wake up every day. And I had some family members going through some addiction issues. And some young people were involved in that scenario. And we got together and said, we love this person, right? We really love this person. And we hope this person gets their act together and they catch up with where we're at in life. But what we have to do is we have to wake up every day and still be the best version of ourselves that we possibly can be. We have to be respectful. We have to treat people right. We have to be good people. We have to be good people for society. And we have to work hard, right? And to me, that is like, you don't have a choice, right? No one's coming to save you, right? No one's coming to save you and you don't have a choice.
As I listen to you, I get this weird combination, this high school basketball coach. We often see glamorized in Hollywood movies. I'm thinking of Gene Hackman, for example, combined with a spiritual feeling. It's raw. It's real. And now that you're in this second phase of your career, do you ever think that you had this higher calling that by surviving the school of hard knocks, you're here to help others do the same?
I did not believe that until so with my sports recruiting business in 2018, I won an award. I was named Emerging Entrepreneur by the Kentucky Entrepreneurs Hall of Fame. And I got up in front of those people and I said very similar things, you know, about these things. And what I learned out of that is the messages that I got, the inboxes that I got, the LinkedIn messages that I got. Hey, it's really brave of you. And I thought, wait a second, what do you mean brave of me? I just got up and told my story. And you realize how much, you know, self-improvement books are the most popular genre of books ever written. The reality of it is there's nothing ever been written in any book anywhere that isn't new. The reality of it is 99% of the people aren't going to do anything with it. So what you know is there's so much room for motivation, improvement, and growth for other people. And for me, that's very much how I've looked at it since then. And I went from that whole hiding in plain sight. This is what I'm doing. To now all of a sudden people are aware of me. They're aware of my ability. They're aware of my success. They're aware of my hard work. They're aware of these skill sets that I have. And it's funny you mentioned the spiritual part. I now live in Lisbon, Portugal, and we'll get to that, I'm sure, at some point. But a dear friend here, before he became a dear friend, a gentleman by the name of Tiago Forjas, a very well-known talent, workplace speaker here. We met and he introduced me at a mystery dinner to a bunch of C-suite executives. And he introduced me as a modern day saint. Now I wear hoodies and he called me a monk. He's like, Shane's a modern day monk. And I'd never really looked at myself that way. And I still makes me a bit uncomfortable to even say that out loud. But to go back to what you said about speaking my truth and sharing these lessons, when you grow up and you don't have a lot, I learned very, very young that your word is the most valuable thing that you have. I don't know why, but God blessed me with the gift of gab. And for some reason, when I speak, people listen. And I learned that if I'm going to open my mouth and I'm going to share something, or I'm going to give someone advice, or I'm going to, you know, mentor them, or what have you, I'm going to do so with a level of authenticity that's what separates me from everyone else. Authenticity and transparency and vulnerability are just, you know, what come naturally to me.
As we close out the show, you mentioned you live in Lisbon, Portugal. I mean, the wonders of technology. I'm taping the show in Costa Rica. And I feel that people are very similar. They don't have a lot, but they have everything. They're happy people. There's a commonality to them. And what you're doing in Lisbon, how you're able to be this agent, connector, and mentor, maybe monk is going to have to go on your title soon for all you do from Lisbon, Portugal.
A lot of the work is kind of transitioning here. I've now become friends with the mayor, who will likely end up being the prime minister at some point of the country. And, you know, it's just a community that has really embraced me and really allowed me to, that when I speak, people listen and, you know, connect the dots. I'm a dot connector, and you can do that kind of remotely now in a world where, you can piece things together. And, you know, I get to help support a guy who, you know, like Steve and Dr. Brad Shuck and Latasha Gillespie and Eric Bailey and so on, that they go out and they make this huge impact in the world, you know, to help others. And ultimately, that's the motivation behind what I've always done in my life. So to have those people around me and be able to do it in a long distance, new age way of, living in Lisbon, Portugal, where it's beautiful weather and great healthcare and amazing people and amazing food and easy travel around Europe. It makes it pretty easy to do.
Are your parents still with you?
My parents are still with me. So, I do not have a relationship with my mother or my father. My father and I wouldn't say mended our relationship, but adjusted our relationship when I have kids, because I never had a grandfather in my life. So I wrote him a big long letter and said, look, I can't forget the things that happened, but I can forgive you. Long story short, that worked for a while. And then about 4 years ago, actually got upset that I was openly speaking about my childhood. And he contacted me and essentially told me I was silly and it was making me look bad that I was talking about these things. And that's the last time we've had a conversation. And I haven't had a full-fledged conversation with my mom in probably 17 years.
You know, Shane, I always end my shows with my three takeaways. And the first one, as much as you were motivated to prove people wrong, I think that Cornelius Martin was your torchbearer. He was the first person to light a path and invite you on it. He saw something with you on that basketball team, spent time talking to you and inspiring you. I think all of us have a Cornelius Martin in our past. Sometimes we're just not willing to accept what they have to say. The second one is what you talked about. You were hidden from plain sight. That's such a great lesson. How many people are out there that we dismiss, that don't seem to fit in, the square pegs trying to jam themselves in a round hole? How important is it for us to open our minds that within anyone is these incredible superpowers to be more and to do more? I'm so glad you're no longer hidden. And I think the most important lesson you talked about is looking through lenses clouded in past pain, grief, and trauma. It's easy to ignore the beauty, but you found a way to have that cataract surgery, to look and see opportunity. Everything you've gone through in that school of hard knocks has set you up to help people outside the classroom. As you said, what's the alternative? Well, there is an alternative, and that's living like you, putting your next foot forward, shoulders up, making sure people understand who you are and why you matter. For all those things and more, it's been an absolute delight chatting with you.
Thanks. Yeah, no, it's. I think you've hit the nail on the head. And yes, a large part of that for me is proving other people wrong. But I think the bigger part in that is showing people what's possible. And you know, if I can overcome all the different things that I've overcome in my life, from, you know, a rough childhood to depression and all these different things, you know, it's not impossible for people in situations. And I know I hope that I can be a positive sight or a glimmer of hope for other people, and a resource where people can reach out and say, hey, you know, I'm going through this, and, you know, do you have any advice, or, you know, what can I do? And those are the things that give me oxygen.
Chatter That Matters has been a presentation of RBC.
It's Tony Chapman. Thanks for listening, and let's chat soon.